But as I was studying, even this morning, Catherine and I both are going to preach this morning. It's going to be a little different. You can just put it very, very low. But I want this picture to show, because I want you to really get into this. I want you to know that the love of the Father is the best love that you can ever have or receive. And even as he was making his way to the cross, he had each one of you on his heart. And I don't know if you're aware of this, but even in John 17, before Christ even made it to the cross, he prayed for us. And I wasn't going to share this morning, but as I seen this video, I felt like I needed to share this for a moment. So as this is going on, I'm going to read it, but it's in John 17, and it says, Christ prays for himself. And it says, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. You are given him authority over all flesh, that he has shown he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, in Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I have glorified you on the earth, and I have finished the work which you have given to me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. Before the world was, you were thought about. And then Christ prays for his disciples. He says, I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of this world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the words which you have given to me, and they have received them and have known surely that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. If you are a disciple, then you're his. And all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to you, Holy Father. Keep through your name those whom you have given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept, and some of them is lost, except the son of perdition or destruction, the scripture might be fulfilled. But I know I've come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the word was hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from all the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. Christ prays for all believers. I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may be one as you and I, Father, are one, and or in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe you sent me, and the glory which you gave me I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. The whole time he goes to the cross, this is right before he took the walk, before he was arrested, before he was nailed to the cross, he prayed for us. What great love he has shown to the world. And the world has denied so much of what he done. But I want to pick up, because we know the story. We know that he was crucified. We know he went down into hell and he took the keys of the kingdom. And he locked the devil up. And so therefore authority was passed down to us, and that we can crucify the enemy. We can put him in chains. We can destroy the works of him trying to destroy us, because he gave us that power. And you must believe that this is truth and that it is his word. Then I just want to pick up, you know, about the resurrection of Christ in John 20. And it says, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved, and said to them, they have taken him, they have taken him away, the Lord, out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. And Peter therefore went out, and the other disciples, and they were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb. And as they stooped down, he was gone. And I'm going to jump down to where Christ appears to Mary. But Mary stood outside of the tomb weeping. As she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. Then they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to him, because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. Now, when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, and did not know that it was Jesus. She followed him. He delivered her of 5 demons. She became wealthy, and she paid mostly for all of his ministry as she walked along with him, and stood next to him and did not even know it was him. Can you imagine? Don't go around in this life and not know Jesus for yourself. Recognize him in everything that is around you. If it's a flower, if it's a star, if it's a chirping of a bird, if it's a dog running in a field, know that that is Jesus in all of what you see. And lay down your life for him as he has for you. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you were carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. And Jesus said to her, Mary. Mary, she turned and said to him, Rabboni, which is saying to the teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and to your God." And so Mary, she came and told them, the disciples, that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. She finally recognized his voice. When she turned, she recognized that small, still voice that still lives inside of us. And he's telling you today, I'm alive. It is well. It is written. It is finished. It is all of those things. And that I now live and dwell on the inside of you. And I send you forth in the name of Jesus. Alexis should understand this. She may be a computer, but she too should understand the resurrection of Jesus Christ if they put it inside of that brain.
That's good.
You are sent individuals into the world. You are to be the continuation of Jesus Christ here on earth. In the kingdom of God.
That's right.
Last week we went over the Great Commission. Before he even went to the cross, he still had you on his heart.
That's right.
And he told his disciples. Then Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And this day, today, on Resurrection Sunday, you're reminded that he has passed on that authority to you. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I command you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of this world, this earth, this age. Always with you. He never leaves you, he never forsakes you. And by God, it's time that we own up and we do the same for him. We recognize him, we know he is the Christ, we know he is alive, we know in his name there is victory. Last night, I didn't even sleep till about 2 o'clock this morning because I was in a battle in my mind. The enemy wanted me to give up and quit and stop. And today, it's because he knew what I was going to be speaking today, what Catherine was going to be speaking today. And we were in a spiritual battle half the night until I said, it's finished. I'm done. I'm not listening to this anymore. I'm going to sleep. And I know the battle is in your mind every day of giving up. Because if I go through that, you do too.
That's right.
But I'm here today saying, you cannot give up because he loved you so much that he died.
That's right.
Fought the enemy,
yes,
so that you may live.
Yes.
And in turn, he's asking you to do your part and to go into the earth and to minister to the lost.
Yes.
He's asking you to help him to complete this until the day he returns. I'm lost. I'm lost in the spirit.
Amen.
I don't even know the scripture I'm looking up, so I gotta look it up, even though I had it marked. Because I'm in awe of what he did for us.
Yes.
Here it is. In chapter 10, Luke 10. After these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also and sent them two by two before his face, and to every city and every place where he himself was about to go. Then he said to them, "The harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord for the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Go your way. Behold, I send you out as lambs among the wolves. Carry neither money bag, sack, nor sandals, and greet no one along the road." He wanted you to have total focus. He wanted you to walk it by spirit. He wanted you to know that he's with you even when he sends you out among the wolves. When he sends you out and he even lets the little things, the foxes, spoil the vine. And it's up to you to make a righteous decision that at any cost you will die for him as he did for you. And it's imperative that we start winning and fighting for the harvest.
Yes.
There are so many souls out there that don't even know what we know. And he wishes that none should perish. And that all, every knee will bow before the name of the Lord Jesus. And so I'm going to turn the rest of the service over to Catherine. But take this serious, because he's serious. He loves you. He died for you. And he wants you to know how much that he even prayed for you before he went to the cross.
You know, I battled all week whether or not to show that Above All video. And the reason is because it is graphic. But what he did on the cross was graphic. What he did on the cross, just as Pastor said, he did for us. And sometimes we forget the pain and the agony that he went through on that cross so that we could be saved. Just thinking that, you know, the night before, when he was being arrested and Pastor read the scripture, when he was praying, he knew the pain that he was going to go through. He knew the agony. But he said, "Father, if this cup could be passed, let it pass. But if not, I'll drink of it." He knew. And for each one of us, he did it. He allowed his body to be beaten, bruised, crucified, so that we could be set free. So I want to read a couple of scriptures because we're talking about harvest, and it's a hot topic right now, all throughout the Church of God. The body of Christ is talking about the harvest. So I went and I looked up some scriptures, and I'm going to read out of my Passion today. And this is Matthew 9, and I can't see which scripture because it's so small. It says, "Jesus walked through the region with a joyful message of God's kingdom realm. And he taught there in their meeting houses and in their synagogues, and where he went to demonstrate God's power by healing every kind of disease and illness. And when he saw the vast crowds of people, Jesus' heart was deeply moved with compassion because they seemed very weary and helpless, like wandering sheep without a shepherd. He turned to his disciples and said, 'The harvest is huge and ripe, but there's not enough harvesters to bring it in. As you go, plead to the owner of the harvest to thrust out many more reapers to harvest his grain.'" And if you'll notice, we've got grain showing everywhere you turn this morning. And there's a reason for that. In the book of Revelations, let me get there real quick. In the book of Revelations 14, It talks about the harvest. It talks about the reapers. It talks about what's about to take place. It says, I looked and behold. Now, this is John telling the story because he's the one that wrote the book, and this is the vision that God's given him. He says, I looked and beheld. I saw a white cloud, and sitting upon it was the one like the Son of Man, wearing a golden crown and holding a sharp sickle. A sharp sickle. He's holding it. Who knows what this is for? It's to reap. It's to go get the harvest. And he says that he saw him sitting with a sharp sickle. Another angel came out of the temple shouting out to the one that was sitting on the cloud, take your sickle and reap, for the time of reaping has come. The harvest on earth is ready. Y'all, I have never in all my days of being saved ever felt like the harvest is ready more than I do today. So the one sitting upon the white cloud gave his sickle a mighty swing over the earth and reaped its harvest.
Yeah.
Then another angel came out of the heavenly temple, and he too had a sharp sickle. And another angel came out from the altar of incense, the angel with authority over fire. And he shouted with a loud voice to the one with the sharp sickle, saying, take your sharp sickle and harvest now. Now, y'all can go back and read the rest of it, but I want to talk about the harvest a little bit, because if you'll notice on this sickle, it's sharp on both sides. So when you sling this sickle, it's heavy, so I've got to prop it. When you sling this sickle, it's going to harvest one way and then the other. Now, he's saying that the harvest is ready. How do you know when a harvest is ready? How do you know when the wheat is ready? When you look at a good stalk of wheat, if I have it here, I'm not going to go grab them. Abby, can you grab me one stalk of wheat, a good straight one? When the wheat is ready, it stands tall. It's actually, when you see a field of wheat, it's very beautiful. And this is what God wishes that the harvest was all about. Thank you, Abby. See, this is a stalk of wheat. Perfectly standing straight. Well, a little bend in it. Perfectly straight. Ready to be harvested. But what's happening in the church today? Why is this message so important? Because a lot of the wheat that's been sitting on the stalk has been broken. Because we're not doing the commission that God gave us. I'm guilty of this too. God broke my heart when Pastor wanted us to do harvest time. And I'm thinking, okay, but how many people have I gone out and led to the Lord? How many people have I gone out and prayed for? How many have I gone and reaped for the Lord? And then as I was preparing stuff today, I'm sitting there not playing with the wheat, but I'm sitting there trying to, it's fragile, y'all. The wheat, it's fragile. And it's not heavy like we think it is. When you think about winning souls, you think, oh, there's the drudgery of winning souls. It's light. It's ready. It's waiting on you. And you. And you. And you. To just go and get it. It's not heavy at all. I can't even say this even weighs anything. And that's the way we need to look at lost souls. It's not going to cost us anything to go lift that up. I have a bad back. I'm thinking I can't go raise up a soul. Soul weighs as much as this week. And the harvest is ready. So I started asking God, okay, God, as I dropped in Pastor's witness, I dropped that wheat. can't tell you how many times on the floor. And I'm sitting there and I'm looking at it on the floor and it's all broken. And almost instantly I felt the Lord saying, this is my church. I said, no, God, that can't be your church, broken and falling apart on the floor. He said, but it is. I said, well, Lord, what do we do? He says, I've told you what to do. Can you go separate? I told you what to do. Pastor read the scripture. Go get them. The harvest is ready. The book says the harvest is ready. So what are we going to do? I'm going to show you what happens if we don't do. There's some of them, just like the weed I showed you with that. Some of them, some people hear about church, their church hurt, their this, their that. They just bend over and cave in to everything that's happened in the world. They give up. They don't even try anymore. They just quit. Nobody's on to them. Nobody's planted a seed. Nobody's come by and watered, and nobody's even coming to harvest. So they just die. And they fall away. Then you've got those to where when we get saved, we are zealous. We're ready to share the gospel. We're ready. We will get ourselves in trouble doing crazy things for God. What happened to that in us? Because here you have a wheat. If you can see the little zigzags, they went to church, they got saved, they fell away. Somebody says something to them, they get back up, they go to church, they get right again, then they fall away. Then they get back up, they serve God for a little while, they may work in the church, but then they fall away. It's a very, very horrible place to be. But there's still hope because it's still on the stalk. It hasn't been reaped yet. There's still hope for this person. How many people do you know in your lives that are still, there's still hope? If there's air in their lungs, there's still hope. I don't care if they're an atheist. I don't care if they're a Satan worshiper. I don't care if they're drug addicts. I don't care. If they have air in their lungs, if they have the breath of God in their lungs, there's still hope. But then we have those, Lord, help me with this, they completely have lost it. They're no longer on the stock. Even if we go to reap, they're not there to reap. We've given up on them. I have family members that, Lord help me, I had family members that I just gave up on because it's the same cycle over and over and over. No matter how many times I've tried to reach out and share the truth, they fall away anyway. So I'm like, God, what's the purpose? What's the reason? And to me, I'm like, Lord, I can't do no more. I just have to let it go. And in some cases, we have to do that. But then they fall to the ground and they die. Not the kind of die where the seed falls to the ground and comes back up. This thing gone. There's no life going to them. They're not attached anymore to the stalk. It's tapped in with the taproot to feed it, to water it, to give it hope. It's gone. How many people do we know like that? So what I want to say is that we've got a decision to make today. Are we going to link arms with the Father and allow Him to use us to swing the sickle because the harvest is ready? It could be that road rage person in front of you who's slamming on their brakes, who's not using a blinker, who's zooming around you and almost causing an accident. they may be one of those fallen pieces, or maybe they're in their bent stage. You know, coming to God, leaving God, coming to God, leaving God. If we don't open our mouths and start lifting them up and praying for them and doing whatever we can to reach them, the harvest is now. How many in here have ever grown a garden? Do you leave your tomatoes on the vine to rot and then go, oh, I'll go harvest them now? What will you have? A moldy, stinky mess. But when those tomatoes are ripe and they're beautiful and they're ready to dig into, that's when you harvest them. In my heart and in my gut and in my spirit, I feel that now is that time to harvest. So what we've done, God gave me a vision about the sickle in his hand. And if you look on this image up here, there's a sickle in his hand. And he's got his hands over the wheat saying, now's the time. He wants to know, will you help him? Will you step out of your comfort zone and reach those people before they fall to the ground? So I gave us an image on the board over here of Jesus standing in a wheat field. It looks simple. It's like, okay, well, that's fine. What do we do with that? You'll see there's some little round discs on there that are hanging beside or hanging below him. These are for you to put names of people that you're believing for. Matter of fact, I have to add another one today that the Lord brought to my memory. Because I don't want to see that person get left behind. I don't want to see that family member lost. I want when his sickle comes through that they go with him. But if we're not praying for them, if we're not reaching out to them, if we're not loving them with the kind of love that was shown in that Above All video, then we can't say we're doing anything. This man laid his life down, physically laid his life down so that we could reach these people. There's little clips up there that you can write their names on here and then put them up there on that poster. Be reminded of the wheat. Be reminded that we have loved ones that are sitting there waiting to be redeemed. And then there's these little things that you can take with you with a little piece of wheat on it. Put it somewhere where you'll see it every day to remind you, what am I doing today to reap the harvest? What am I going to say today to that person who may not know him? Lord, what can we do today when we leave this place? If you're going through a drive-through, leave a person with the word at the window. You know, it's Resurrection Sunday. I'm praying that you have the best day of your life today. And just know that Jesus loves you. It's that simple. Why we try to complicate it and create formulas and programs to do it for us, I don't know. The disciples didn't have that. The 70 plus other people that Pastor talked about when he sent them out two by two, they didn't have that. They just went with the unadulterated Word of God. No sugar coating, no puff and smoke and nothing like that. They just went out with the pure Word of God to reach the people. But first, we must be able to reach the people. Do we have that resurrection power living within us? The Bible says we do. Because everything Jesus did, we can do too, if we believe. So I'm just challenging you, if you want to be commissioned, if you want to rededicate your life, and I don't care if you serve here, I don't care what you do, I don't care how much you know, but if you need to get your life in order with God, I'm going to open up this altar. And I'm going to say, Lord, come and have your way. I may be joining you at the feet of the cross because I need my heart changed too. I want to have that same compassion when Jesus looked out and saw the sickness of the sheep walking around like they have no shepherd. Have you ever seen a little sheep all alone by itself without anybody shepherding it? I should have printed those out. It is the most saddest thing you can ever see. It's very sad. They're weak. They're lame. Their fur or their fleece is so out of order. It's a mess. But those that have the shepherd taking care of them are beautiful. Their fleece is incredible. Their countenance, yes, they have a countenance, is cheerful and welcoming. So I'm opening up these altars, and I'm asking you to come forward if you feel that you need to get right before God.
As you come forward, I just want to tell you that it started for me. I had to go and wash clothes at the laundromat because, you know, I'm waiting on my washer. And there was this little black man in there sweeping, dusting, taking out the garbage. And I said, sir, do you own this place? He said, no, ma'am, I just work here. I've been here about 3 years. And I said, I just want to tell you that you do such an awesome job. I said, every time I come here, I don't come often, but when I come, it's always clean. And we got to talking, and before we knew it, we realized we were neighbors. Yes. And you know, Rich dropped off a couple of signs at his house before, and he was tickled. That's where I know you from. And then we got to talking about Jesus. And he says, since you believe in the Lord, and you believe in, you know, angels and demons, he said, let me ask you something. And he said, I was sitting on my porch one day, just sitting there, and I looked up and I seen my mama and my sister's face. And she spoke to me and she said, son, if your life isn't ready, get ready.
That's right.
Because now is the time. Jesus is coming back. And he started crying right there in the laundromat. He said, do you think that was real? I said, yes, it was. And I said, would you like me to pray for you? He said, please. He said, I need to get right. My mama told me to get right. Right there in that laundromat with other people around, we prayed the sinner's prayer, and he wept. When she says this harvest is ripe and it's ready, it's that simple.
Yes.
Just be loving, be kind, be full of joy, and just give someone a compliment. They may need that.
Yes.
He was so overjoyed that I recognized that he kept that place so clean. It was my open door.
Yes.
And before I left, he said, I'll never forget you, ma'am. And I said, well, you know, we're praying for some property here in Albany. When we get to this spot, would you come to my church? He said, you come to my door, knock on my door, because you know where I live, and you tell me your church is in Albany, I'm going to be there. I understand a lot of people don't want to come all the way to Walker, and it's fine because we're just here for a moment. But I'm telling you, it's time to be so serious about the things of God. It's time that you sell out and you get off of that media. You quit pretending that there's nothing else to do but what you, yourself, wants to do. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. and what he did for us daily. It's a daily walk. It's a daily commitment. It's a daily love. Because he daily loved us. And every time he walked around healing and delivering and setting people free, it was in preparation for the day. And this is the day. So, Catherine, you come on up. And if you want us to pray with you, we'll pray with you. If you want to just go kneel, you go kneel. You want to lay out, you lay out. But you let God deal with your heart once and for all. And lay yourself down. And pick up his cross and follow him wherever you go.
Thank you, Father God. I just think we all need to pray this. I don't care who you are. Even out in Facebook. If you don't know where you are or where you stand with God, just pray with us. Father God, y'all just repeat after me. Father God.
Father God.
I come to you boldly today.
I come to you boldly today.
And I ask you to forgive me.
I ask you to forgive me.
Forgive me, Lord.
Forgive me, Lord.
For not taking your commission seriously.
For not taking your commission seriously.
Cleanse me, Father God.
Cleanse me, Father God.
Of everything.
Of everything.
That leads me away from you.
That leads me away from you.
And Lord,
Lord,
I ask you
for compassion
for the lost,
for the lost,
just like you had for me,
just like you had for me.
Let me see your lost children.
Let me see your lost children
through your eyes.
Through your eyes,
move through me, Lord.
Move through me, Lord.
Use me.
Use me, Lord.
And allow your resurrection power.
And allow your resurrection power.
Change this world today.
Change this world today.
I am a child of God.
A child of God.
Filled with the Holy Spirit.
Filled with the Holy Spirit.
And commanded.
And commanded.
To go out.
To go out.
And reap the harvest.
And reap the harvest.
Lord, do this in us this week.
Lord, do this in us this week.
In Jesus' name. If you need prayer, come up. And then after that, I'm going to play a song called The Commission. And I want you to listen to those words carefully. So if you need prayer, come up. Satara. Thank you, Father God. Lord, I thank you for Sean. I thank you, Father God, that he says, today is my day. Today is my day, Lord. I surrender it all to you. Everything that's caused you to grieve over me, Lord. Father God, I give it up to you. I surrender it to you. Now, Lord, you see your son. Fill him, Father God. Fill him, Lord, as he's surrendering today. Move on his body. Father God, move on his spirit. Move in his life. Father God, let today be the beginning of the rest of his life. Let him see, Father God, you in every place he turns. In the name of Jesus, Father, supernatural healing. In the name of Jesus. See, he hayat thank you, Father God. We praise you, God. We lift you, Lord. We trust in you, Lord. Father, just like that video showed, you gave your all and then some. So that we, Father God, can walk free, healed, without shame or guilt. Father, we pray for our family members watching by Facebook. And Father God, I declare you healed in the name of Jesus. I declare you freed in the name of Jesus. Not because I pray it, but because he paid it all for you. Father God, send out your Holy Spirit and minister to every person watching. Father God, heal those with the broken backs. Heal those with the broken spirits, Father God. Heal those, Father God, that have been church hurt and even family hurt. Father, I pray that you would go and minister to each one of them. Each one of them, Father God. He, hi, ya, ta, 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 vocal.
Devil, you are a liar. You are a stealer. You have trespassed on my son and my daughter for too long, and I demand you to go in Jesus' name. You cannot and you will not destroy them, for they are called by your name and ministry to do the work of the kingdom. And from this day, you cannot torment them anymore. You cannot break them down anymore. You cannot cause anger in their hearts towards one another anymore. And God, you would cause their minds to be stayed upon you in Jesus' name. Heal. Heal his body, Lord. Let it be a miracle, God. That, Lord God, even all of this repair work that the doctors did, Lord, let it go back to being normal, like brand new. Let it be a sign from heaven that you're with Shalom, God. And Angie, Lord Jesus, we pray for both of them. Lord, that you are resurrecting them both. Lord God, you're resurrecting them today. This is a new day that has dawned upon their life, God. And they will not look back anymore in Jesus' name. Thank you, God, for doing a quick work. Thank you, God, for putting them into the kingdom of God where they are supposed to be. And equip them and walk with them and show them and guide them to every person that you put in their way, God. Even the drug dealers, even the broken down friends. Lord God, let them be, oh God, a couple on fire for the harvest,
Lord.
In Jesus' name. If you have anything, Catherine, Al, you and your boys, do y'all want prayer? Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Okay, I'd like y'all to just sit and listen to this next song.
Praise.
Listen to the words. Because this is what God's asking us to do. And if you know the song, sing with me.